Random House Audible presents God's Equation, Einstein, Relativity, and the Expanding Universe by Amir D. Aczel. Preface. In January 1998, the way we perceive the universe changed forever. Astronomers found evidence that the cosmos is expanding at an ever-increasing rate. As soon as the new findings were announced, cosmologists from all over the world rushed to try to explain the underlying phenomenon. The most promising theory these scientists could come up with was one that Albert Einstein had proposed 8 decades earlier and quickly retracted, calling it his greatest blunder. Every year, new developments prove the accuracy of Einstein's theories. But if the cosmologists' new assessments are correct, then Einstein was right, even when he was sure he was wrong. About the time this astounding news was being reported, I received a curious piece of mail. It was sent to me by L.P. LaBelle, a reader of my book Fermat's Last Theorem, who had become a friend, and with whom I'd been exchanging letters. This time, however, the envelope contained no letter, simply a cutting of an article written by George Johnson in the New York Times. I read the article with great interest. It was about pure mathematics, not physics or cosmology. In the article, Mr. Johnson posed an intriguing question. Is it possible that other forms of mathematics, different from our own, exist somewhere in the universe? As an example, Johnson gave the problem of pi and the circle. Is it possible, he asked, for circles to exist with ratio of circumference to diameter not equal to pi? Einstein and cosmology would seem, on the face of it, to have nothing to do with weird mathematics where circles are not the way we know them. But a strong connection existed, as I knew well. Contemplating these parallel issues of physics and mathematics took me back 2 decades. During my student days at the University of California at Berkeley, I took courses in physics and mathematics. In one of these courses, the professor explained a concept that challenged my perception of things. The electron, the professor said, lives in a different space from the one we live in. This statement made me change my academic direction, and from then on pursue courses that dealt with spaces, topology, analysis, and differential geometry. I wanted to understand these different spaces that exist even if our senses cannot detect them. Such strange spaces apply to the very small, in quantum mechanics, or the very large, in general relativity. To understand the physics of relativity, one had to study a space whose geometry worked counter to our intuition. Johnson's weird mathematics and the cosmologists' Einsteinian equations were really 2 sides of the same coin. Slowly, I became obsessed with these fascinating ideas. I spent hours solving problems in non-Euclidean geometry, a branch of mathematics that deals with spaces in which a line may have infinite parallels through a given point instead of Euclid's single line, and where circles have ratios of circumference to diameter different from pi. Albert Einstein studied non-Euclidean geometry when he was searching for a mathematical theory that would account for the curvature he discovered in space-time. I reworked old problems in differential geometry, another form of geometry used by Einstein when he needed a mathematical basis for his nascent theory of general relativity. And I spent time going through all of Einstein's papers on general relativity. Recently, having refreshed my understanding of the mathematics of relativity theory, I called one of my old Berkeley professors to ask him some questions about the geometry of general relativity. S.S. Chern is arguably the greatest living geometer. We spoke on the phone for a long time, and he patiently answered all my questions. When I told him I was contemplating writing a book about relativity, cosmology, and geometry, and how they interconnect to explain the universe, he said, "It's a wonderful idea for a book, but writing it will surely take too many years of your life. I wouldn't do it." Then he hung up. I was determined to explain to myself the exact relationship between an ever-expanding universe Einstein's ingenious field equation of general relativity, and the enigmatically curved universe in which we live. If I could explain these mysteries to myself and satisfy my own growing curiosity, I felt, then I could share this knowledge with others. I read every book I could find about cosmology and relativity, but to truly understand these fascinating ideas, I had to derive the equations myself. In this task, other people proved more helpful than I would ever have expected. My friend and neighbor, Alan Guth, the Weisskopf Professor of Physics at MIT, is the discoverer of the most promising theory to explain what happened right after the Big Bang, the theory of the inflationary universe. Guth's theory is so successful that it is now the backbone of virtually every cosmological model of the universe. Alan was generous in sharing with me his research papers and spending hours with me discussing cosmology and the strange geometry of space-time. Peter Dermoshkin, who also teaches physics at MIT, kindly shared his lecture notes on cosmology and helped me through some hairy equations. Jeff Weeks, a mathematician and consultant, helped me see the exact mathematical connection between Einstein's field equation with a cosmological constant and the possible geometries of the universe. Colin Adams, a mathematician at Williams College, was helpful in further exploring these hidden links between geometry and the mathematical formulas describing the universe. Kip Thorne, a world-renowned professor of relativity at Caltech and an expert on black holes, was kind enough to answer questions in a telephone interview. Paul Steinhardt, a professor of physics at Princeton University and a pioneer in the areas of cosmology and physics as well as pure mathematics, shared his insights and theories with me. Sir Roger Penrose of Oxford University, a renowned mathematician and cosmologist, generously shared his original ideas and theories of the universe. Once I understood the mathematics and the physics and could actually see how the equations determined the geometry and how Einstein's once maligned cosmological constant amazingly fit into the puzzle of an ever-accelerating universe, it came time to speak with the astronomers. Harbingers of news about the state of our universe. Saul Perlmutter of the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, head of the international team of astronomers who broke the news about the fast-expanding universe, was generous with his time. Saul gave me unique insights into the physical process of an expanding space, as well as information on the ingenious methods he and his team members had devised in order to detect and measure universal expansion using electronic images of exploding stars billions of light years away. Later, Saul also went through the manuscript of this book and gave me many valuable suggestions. Esther M. Hu, head of a team of astronomers at the University of Hawaii, who glimpsed through the Keck telescopes a vision of the most distant object visible in the universe, a galaxy 13 billion light years away, whose light was so dim and so far shifted to red as to seem at the limit of what we could hope to see, described to me her amazing experience. She was also generous in providing me with many interesting technical details about her discovery, including the fact that the galaxy she observed was receding from us at 95.6% of the speed of light. Netta A. Bacall, a professor of astronomy at Princeton University, who has been studying the mass density of the universe with the most advanced observational and theoretical tools, shared with me her surprising research results. All the studies Netta and her colleagues have conducted over the past decade indicate that our universe has low mass, as little as 20% of the minimum mass density required to eventually stop the universal expansion. This research gives strong indications that the universe will expand forever. My friend Jay Pasikoff, director of the Hopkins Observatory at Williams College, was my host at Williamstown, Massachusetts. One summer day while I was deep into the project of writing this book, I had come to talk with him because I was now researching the work of Albert Einstein himself. I knew that Einstein's theory of general relativity was confirmed from observations of the bending of starlight around.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.